Hello, and welcome to another edition of Hall Talk. My name is Frank Frasco, and the madness of March has officially settled on the campus of Seton Hall as the Pirates men's team upset the Golden Eagles of nationally ranked number 16 Marquette Wednesday night with another remarkable team effort led by Miles Powell. The women's team ended their regular season campaign with an epic battle out in Queens, defeating St. John's and now having to play the Red Storm once again in their Big East tournament. How will both teams fare in the remainder of this season? You'll find out here. This is Hall Talk. And we welcome you back to Hall Talk. I'll now introduce my panel, Chris Russo, Liam Plate. Guys, how are we doing?
Doing fine. Thank you very much.
Doing good. Happy to be here.
So just analyzing that Marquette victory, they won 73-64. And a big performance by the guy behind us, Miles Powell, had 34 points. That's his third highest scoring performance of the season. But Chris, I'll start with you. Who surprised you in this victory?
I think for me, it actually had to be Quincy McKnight. Not a fantastic game offensively, not the game that the gentleman behind us had, but Quincy McKnight did a very good job defensively and shut down Marcus Howard significantly, and enough that Sam Hauser's great play didn't make enough of an impact for Marquette to still win the game.
For me, I didn't really pick anyone, but I'm just surprised with how the team limited fouls. Marquette only went to the line 5 times and shot 10 free throws. Well, they made 7 of them, so they shot 70%. But if you can limit a team's opportunity at the line, you can win games, which we saw on Wednesday, which, considering they did a great job, considering they let DePaul shoot 38 foul shots when they played them at home, which and ultimately gave the game away.
I mean, I just want to go back to McKnight, because he drew 3 fouls on Marcus Howard, and Howard had to sit out for 10 minutes of that second half, and that was really a difference maker.
But yeah, well, that was also a move that Coach Wojciechowski made that, you know, maybe he spent a little too much time on the bench, and that made a difference. Maybe Marquette could have put that game away, but they got him in trouble early. Howard had his first foul very early on in the game. He had 2 fouls at the half, and he had 3 fouls, I think, within 2 minutes of the second half. And Marcus Howard is the guy, no doubt. No matter how deep this team is, Marcus Howard's the guy you want to get off the floor as soon as possible.
And he only had 3 points coming into the second half. My guy would have to be Romero Gill. He had 25 minutes, 7 points in 25 minutes. He led the team in the plus and minus with 13, and he's just a strong player. You put him on the floor, he took away the 3 guys, Theo John, Joey Hauser, and Ed Morrow. He held them to 19 points in total, those 3 guys, and there was really no big man coming into this game. Theo John had that early technical foul with Mike Enzi, and pretty much he was non-existent. He finished the game with 6 points.
Yeah, and I think that might not have helped him because, you know, psychologically, that's just not good. I think John was more the aggressor in that argument, but neither guy was very smart on the play, and that really must not have helped his game mentally going on further into the game. You know, they did a good job. Joey Hauser, honestly, like as good a job as Gil did, I think Joey Hauser, I think, ruined it for himself because he had a lot of open shots that he just frankly missed.
I agree. Did you notice anything, Liam, from this game that was different from another performance that they had in the latter half of this Big East season?
Well, one stat that stands out to me is points in the paint. They really got underneath, scored. They outscored Marquette 42-20, which I think they're learning from their early season mistakes from shooting a lot of threes. Now, granted, they did shoot 20 threes this game. They went 4-for-20 from behind the three-point line, but it is good that they're improving their inside scoring because that's how you win games, especially in a tough conference like the Big East, when you have a lot of good big guys and you have to get in there and be strong with the ball. So I think they're doing better, and like they're definitely improving throughout conference play.
One guy who's been not strong in the paint, guy behind us, Sandro Mamukelashvili. He played 20 minutes, 0 points, 1 rebound. It was a pretty pathetic performance, and they still got the job done. But you saw players like Roden and Gill step up. My question is for you, Liam, I'll start with you. Who would you think they should replace? Jared Roden or Romero Gill in replacing Sandro to start in, you know, the game coming up for Villanova?
I have to go with Jared Roden. I mean, he's perfect from the free throw line. He's hit a lot of big shots, and he's actually been the one replacing Mamu in the second half when Mamu has not been playing well, which he has not been playing well this past few games, as you just said. But I think if they threw Roden in there, it'd be a different look. Go small a little bit. He's a little bit shorter. So I think it'd be a good look for them. And, like, Roden's better at getting inside than Mamu actually is. Mamu likes to play like a guard, likes to shoot threes. But I think Roden would do a better job playing inside. He knows his role.
Here's my thoughts are a little complicated on the matter. Now, the Roden-Gill thing, I think it's more of a week-to-week basis or a game-to-game basis. It depends on what kind of big men you actually have. Now, Villanova is not that deep a team, as good as they've been this year. Really, it's Pascal and Booth. Those are the two guys you have to watch. Neither of them is as big as Gill is. So I think it's going to have to be sort of a platoon between Roden and Sandro. Gill did not look great for a lot of that Marquette game. Obviously, in the end, pretty good stats. 3 blocks, 4 rebounds, and really good for him, 7 points, which may not be good for a lot of players, but it's great for him. I think they should platoon them because they match up a lot better with physically with Booth and Pascal. I'd start Roden if I had picked one of the two to start.
I would say Roden too, because Sandro, he had 4 minutes. He had 4 points in 28 minutes of action out in Philadelphia against Villanova in late January. So I think Gill can make that impact. He can get out there. He has that defensive presence, you know, being 7 feet tall. So my biggest thing, and we're going to transition into the Villanova game, Russo, I'll start with you. What do the Pirates need to do, and can they go into the Big East tournament having beaten two top 25 teams?
I think it's absolutely possible. Now, going into these last two games, I said, okay, Marquette's the better team than Villanova. I think that's definitely true, even after this game. But considering what Seton Hall did at Marquette and what they did at Villanova, I also thought it was much more likely that they would beat the Golden Eagles than they would beat the Wildcats. That being said, you know, Seton Hall is probably their biggest win outside of Kentucky. Going into the Villanova game, Marquette is the second biggest win, huge momentum swing, and I think it's absolutely possible for them to knock off Villanova and go into the tournament with some huge momentum.
Yeah, I definitely have to agree with Chris there. I give them a chance just because the way they played against Marquette, played very well. One thing they need to do is they need to limit Villanova's shooting. They need to limit their shooting because that's what killed them in the last game. Villanova was making shot after shot after shot, and one in particular player is Phil Booth. They just need to stop Phil Booth, and then I think if they keep, and they need to keep it close as well. So I think they keep it close, stop Phil Booth, limit their shooting from behind the three-point line, and then I think they'll have a shot.
I think they need to limit the Wildcats' second half. In the Villanova game, they went on a 23-6 run to enter the second half. Phil Booth and Eric Pascal, they combined for 42 points. So it was just a remarkable effort by those two senior Wildcats. They also had to shut down the forwards. Jermaine Samuels against Marquette, he had a career-high 29 points, so he's a fantastic player. But also, what you see with this Eric Pascal, the senior forward, is that he can get shut down. He only had 4 points in that Marquette loss. So this is in 39 minutes of action. So this is going to be a fun matchup for the Pirates. But we're going to head into Big East basketball inside the tournament. And I want to start with you, Russo. Predictions with rankings, opponents, and how far will the Pirates go?
Okay, so here's the thing. Now, this is like an NFL playoff picture going into week 17 if we're talking about what's going on, how jumbled up these teams are, how close they are in the standings. So, right now, I'm going to say Seton Hall gets the 4 seed because I say they pull off the upset against Nova. It's possible. You never know. St. John's would have to beat Xavier, which I think they will. Georgetown loses at Marquette, which I think is pretty fair to say. Seton Hall is the 4 seed, faces Creighton, after Creighton will knock off DePaul this weekend. I say Seton Hall knocks off Creighton, and I think they're going to play Marquette close in the second round if they can get there. And that should be good enough, I think, to get them into the NCAA tournament.
Liam, quickly.
Yeah, I potentially see this team going to the semifinals, kind of like what Chris said. I see them getting the 4 seed, but instead of Creighton, I think Georgetown's going to be able to be good. They've been playing pretty well, that they'll get the 5th seed, so they'll play them. But then I think it'll be a tough game against Marquette, especially a team like Marquette. They're going to want revenge after they just lost. So it'll be a tough one. They could win it, but they could lose it as well. So I think the farthest I see them going is semifinals.
Right now the Pirates are a number 5 seed. They would play Georgetown right now. I think they get the win versus Villanova. and they end up losing in the semifinal, but they'll end up making it to the NCAA tournament, and that's a whole other conversation. We're going to move into women's basketball, and the person behind me, Shadeen Samuels, she won the Big East scoring title, averaging 20.5 points per game. Remarkable performance, and they finished their regular season campaign by defeating the Red Storm 76-72. I was out in Queens for that. What was your analysis, Russo, on that game?
Look, Seton Hall did a good job. They pulled away in the first half. They did a great job coming back in the second half, but they needed to play a more complete game. I think they also needed to spread the ball out a little more because Shadeen Samuels had a fantastic 33 points. Nicole Jimenez was very good as well, but they didn't really spread the ball around as much. As for Samuels winning the scoring title, it is well-deserved. She is arguably, if not definitely, the best player in the Big East Conference in women's basketball. And she's the best player on this team, obviously, on both ends of the floor. She's a great two-way player, and she has represented the program very well.
What key takeaways did you really get from that St. John's game?
That the Pirates need to pound it inside. Samuels had 33. Elmore had 19, I think. If they keep doing that, they can win games in the Big East tournament. And I think definitely, I'm not surprised Samuels won the scoring title. I mean, time and time again, she's carried this team, and we've seen the impact her absence has on the court when she's not playing, especially in that Marquette game when they lost 109-66.
It'll be Seton Hall versus St. John's on Saturday at 3:00. The winner takes on Marquette. So, Chris, we'll just go into that. I mean, this Marquette team, Natasha Heidemann, she unanimous Big East Player of the Year. They have four players that average double digits in scoring. That's a tough opponent.
That is a tough opponent. That's the one opponent that I think Seton Hall will really absolutely have some trouble with if they can get to them in the Big East tournament, because they took down DePaul. DePaul's the second-best team in the conference. And they took them down on the road. Obviously, it was a very disappointing loss here at Walsh Gymnasium, but you know they're capable of something. That game was not a fluke, even if they did lose the second one. So I think they're capable of doing great things in the tournament, but if they get to Marquette, it's going to be very tough.
Well, we know one thing. It's going to be one fun postseason, but that's all the time we have for now. So for Lean Plate, Chris Russo, my name is Frank Frasco. See you next time.